An idea of what we were going to be talking about today, but I want to ask this question right now, and we're going to do a poll right now. How many people would say that you are an introvert? Raise your hand. Meaning you get recharged by, you get recharged, my daughter's trying to skip ahead. Okay, raise your hand, introverts. You get recharged by being alone. Perfect. Extroverts, raise your hand.
Yeah!
Yeah! Wow, there are way more introverts than extroverts. So give somebody, put your hand back up, and give somebody a high five. Yes. You know what? It takes all kinds here at Via Church. And I wanted to show you this. A lot of people think being an introvert is a bad thing, but it's not. My clicker's not working. Santo Niño. it's not a bad thing. Actually, 1 in 3 people are introverts. In fact, in this room, it's flipped the opposite way. Like, there are more introverts than extroverts. But this is one way you can kind of tell. Introverts love, like, intimate drinks or, like, intimate pizza. Like, if you have pizza by yourself, you love that one.
Yes.
They love email or text. They work better alone. Don't touch me. Don't talk to me, right? They're tired. Like, we can go to a party or go to something, and, like, we get home, my wife is like, tired, bro, like dead tired. You okay? I'm just tired. But they get tired after socializing, but they're deep thinkers, they're good writers, they're easily distracted. Extroverts, people like me, they love big parties, they love to talk on the phone, gab, 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 party, right? They're good team workers. They get euphoria. It's like this thing that happens for us when we're around a crowd. Oh my gosh, it's amazing. Good speakers, maybe not so much, but we get easily bored. But I wanted to show you just a quick snapshot, because once again, being an introvert, people like this sometimes think that their personality is like, it's like a handicap. We're like, man, if I was more, It's not like that at all. Actually, check this out. These are some famous introverts. Bill Gates, my man Abe, you know what I mean? Abe Lincoln. Albert Einstein, Gandhi, Rosa Parks, Warren Buffett, even J.K. Rowling, right? Right? All these famous people that get recharged by being alone. Now, the thing that I want you to know this morning is that neither personality is better, introvert versus extrovert. It's not like one is better, one is good, one is bad. It's just like we all have feet, you know what I mean? Mine are beautiful. Okay. What are you still doing in here? Can you take off? Sheesh. If you're online, she said no, they're not. Everybody has feet, you know what I mean? So either, but neither kind of feet, hairy feet are good, but neither is better.
And sharp.
Okay, how did this turn into a bastard?
Man, you smell funny. Man, you sing off key.
But the truth is, neither personality is better, but nobody likes to be alone. Okay? And even introverted people, they don't like being like all alone. Danessa loves to have me next to her. It's funny, she will watch a show by herself, like Flea Market Flip. You guys ever watch that? That's okay. She'll watch that show and be okay. She'll like, it's good. But as soon as I sit down, she does this thing where she leans over and like, she puts her head right here for about 30 seconds. Then she complains how bony my shoulders are. Ah, you're so bony, and she'll hit me. And then she rolls this way, and then she falls asleep. But she can't fall asleep unless I'm right there. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Now, she doesn't want me to talk or engage with her anyway. I'm just supposed to sit there and keep her company. So it's not, and then she can fall asleep. And then halfway through our show, I'm like, bah. So she's seen the first 10 minutes of every show that we've ever watched. But the point is that people that are introverts, it's not that they hate people. Nobody wants to be alone. And that feeling of alone, that feeling of isolation, that feeling of there's nobody with me, that's almost the worst feeling we can have, okay? This isn't in my notes, but I'm gonna camp here for just 1 second. God said this, he said, I am, right? I am with you. Like, I am present, I am here. When he sent his son, he said, you will call his name what? Emmanuel, which means God understands, he recognizes that nobody likes to be alone. I found this as I was doing some studies. Loneliness, people that would admit, I'm lonely. Here's some of the symptoms that happen to people that are lonely. Increased risk of stroke and heart attack, loneliness, anxiety and depression, inflammation and tissue damage, high blood pressure, increased risk of memory loss and dementia. Couples that have been married years and years and years, when the spouse dies, like, they just lose it. Like, being alone is so bad. Even suicide, it's just terrible, this feeling of loneliness. I found this fact. According to Forbes, loneliness might be a bigger health risk than smoking or obesity. What? Loneliness, being alone. Everybody say alone. And God knew this. God created us like this. He designed us like this. In Genesis chapter 2, verse 18, and if you have a Bible or a smartphone, you can turn there. I want you to highlight some of this. We're going to be in Genesis for a couple of verses, and then we're going to be in the book of John. But pull out your smartphone. We're in Genesis chapter 2, verses 18. We're just looking at the first part, Genesis chapter 2, verse 18. But I want to paint a real quick picture. The picture is this. God created the heavens and the earth. He created a paradise. Everything is perfect. Everybody say perfect. I mean, the waves are perfect. The weather is perfect. Everything is perfect. And he created a man, puts him in this garden. This guy has never sinned. He's never had a bad day. He's never had stink feet. You know what I mean? He's super muscular. Anyways, everything is perfect. Everything is perfect. I mean, like, it doesn't get better than this moment, right? Think about your favorite day. If you're watching online, think about the best day ever, the day that you wish you could live over and over and over. Think about that day, and then multiply it times perfection and no sin and no gas, right? Right? Nothing. I mean, nothing is perfect. And here's what God says. This is Genesis chapter 2, verse 18. In fact, read this with me. Ready? Then the Lord God said, it is not good for the man to be alone. I just finished telling you it was perfect. There was nothing wrong with this. This was the best day ever. And God said, nope, it's not good. It's not good. And what is not good? For the man to be alone. God understood this. He recognized what being alone does to us. He knew it. He built us. That's why here at Elevate, and I don't know if you, even some people are kind of newer to the church, but we have what we call the core four. But it's Elevate God, Experience Community, Empower the Church, and Embrace the Mission. But I wanted to zoom in right here. We recognize it's so important. It's a necessity. It's not just something that is, whatever. It's a necessity to experience community. You can't just watch it. People that watch Netflix are still lonely. You know what I mean? You can't just watch Korean dramas and think you're in the drama. Like, it's like you have to experience community. And this is why we're not just doing church. We're doing life. So we're going to burn through this really quickly. But if you're taking notes, this is our first point. Why is community so important? Number one, it's our design. It is our design. God created this this way. Take a look at this video.
In the first chapter of Genesis, there's this really interesting thing that happens where God says, let us make man in our own image. Now, that's plural. It says, let us make man in our own image. Now, he's talking about the Trinity there. The Father, the Son, and the Spirit are then creating us out of their own very image and breath, which means this community, the Father, the Son, and the Spirit, if we're created in their image, then that means it's in our very identity that we are created for community as well. It's actually trying to live without community is like trying to live without oxygen. It's a very part of what it means to be human. I think a lot of times, though, we fall on the other side of that. We think we can just follow Jesus all by ourselves, just he's our best friend, and we have no church community. We have no people around us that are helping us through life. But God gave us this family that actually is where true joy comes. comes from. I mean, trying to live without the church is like trying to sit on a stool with one peg. You might be able to do it decently successful in regards to how you're showing yourself to the world, but it'll be very difficult and much harder. It wasn't created to act like that. We were created for community. We were created to be in the family of God.
And I think for us as a church, this is one of the things that I feel like I'm saying more times than anything else I say. For us here at Elevate, we want to do life. We want to put doing life over doing church. Does that make sense? Because we all have clubs, we all have things that we go to, things that we might be a part of. But for us, we want to be able to look around and say, oh, we're doing life with these people. This is our family. This is our ohana. These are the people that we are living with. And so that's why here at Elevate, this is one of our values. Why is community so important? Number one, it's our design. Number two, it's our duty. Everybody say duty. Duty. Everybody say duty. Makes me think of this movie every time because I'm childish. Maybe I'm not meant for these duties. Cooking duty. Vodka duty. Maybe it's time for me to get a better duty. Never seen the movie. Go watch it. Sorry. Somebody online's like, ooh, I love that movie. They just switched over to YouTube. Listen. It's our duty to be in community. It's our, like, it's what God's called us to. It's not just our design. It's also our responsibility to be in community. Let me say it like this. It's God's expectation that we do life together. That's what he designed us for, and he expects us to walk that out. We're going to switch over to the book of John. This is John chapter 17. We're going to be in John chapter 17, and we're going to read one verse in chapter 14. But this is John chapter 17, verses 20 and 21. And Jesus, if you read, I just read through the book of John. It's a great book, man. It's got so much insight into the way that Jesus thinks. But he's nearing the end of his life, and he knows it's coming. And so he gets his disciples around him, and this is kind of like one of his final addresses to his disciples. And he says this prayer he tells them what he's praying. Does that make sense? So he's not like praying, but he says, here's what I pray. And it's important because at the end of his life, he's kind of trying to summarize all these things to his disciples. And he says, here's what I pray for you. Would you ever wonder what Jesus prays for you? Like what he's praying for you right now. The Bible says that Jesus is seated at the right hand of God the Father, and he's interceding. He's praying for us to his Father. Hey, Dad, would you help Josh? Hey, Dad, would you help? Tell me. And these are some of the things that he's praying to his dad. So here's what he's explaining. This is John chapter 17, verse 20. He says, I'm praying not only for these disciples, the 12 that I'm looking at, but also for all who will ever believe in me through their message. If you've got a right thumb, I want you to raise your hand. Right thumb. Everybody. Good. Someone's like, I got thumbs, yeah. Okay, this is you and me. Does that make sense? Jesus is praying for you and for me. I'm praying not only for these ones that I can see, but for all of us. You didn't know you were in the Bible. You're right here. And here's what he says. I pray that they will all be what? One. Let's stop real quick. I pray that they will all be what?
One.
Ha. Not two. Not three. One. I'm praying for you that you would be one. But let me explain to you how you're one. Ready? Just as you and I. Who is Jesus talking to? Right? So he says, I pray that they will be one just as you and I are one. And then he throws this in there so that he can explain, because these guys are going, what? Just like you're kind of going, eh? He says, as you are in me, Father, and I am in you. So you can imagine, as Jefferson just said, in the beginning, they had community and they were all together. Now Jesus is saying, my prayer for you is that you will be one, just like we are one. Because I'm in you, and you're in me. And then here's the kicker. And may they be in who?
Us.
And the amazing thing about this is that this is the picture God is painting. And you guys know this, but maybe you haven't applied it to church. What I mean is, you have your crew, right? You've got your squad, bro. And they might be squad from high school, they might be squad from work, they might be squad from Kula Halal, right? But you've got your squad. The question is, are they pointing you towards God or drawing you away? Right? We all know the importance of it, even the introverts. We all know. And Jesus is saying, dude, my prayer for these disciples and for everybody is that they would be one just like me and my dad are one. I'm in him, he's in me, and we would be in them. It's powerful. If you really take a second and really consider God's perspective, Jesus' perspective for you. And it's amazing because he says that we would be in them so that the world would believe that God sent me. He puts it like this another way. He says, they will know that you're my disciples by how you love each other. That's what it's supposed to, like, I'm a Bronco fan because I got Bronco stickers, right? Like, I got the stickers, right? I'm a bodybuilder because I got big muscles. That's how you know. I lost him. Don't look away. Okay? That's how you know. Like, he's saying, this is how they're going to know that I'm from God, is how you love each other. So, why is community so important? It's our design. It's our duty. And finally, it is our destiny. Everybody say destiny. For you might not have understood this. Many of you, and I think everybody here has a relationship with God, but many of you didn't understand when you said yes to Jesus because you felt his drawing, right? You felt his conviction. You felt all this stuff. You felt his love and his grace and his peace and his goodness. You didn't recognize that you were saying yes to a relationship necessarily. You said, yes, I believe, but he was actually inviting you into community. That was God's goal for you. This is John chapter 14, verse 2. Jesus is talking to his disciples. This is in the same kind of place. He says, there is more than enough room in my Father's home. If this were not so, would I have told you that I'm going to prepare a place for you? He's talking about this place that he's going to fix up so that we can go. Right? Imagine you met somebody at the beach and you're like, dude, you're dope, bro. I like you. You know what? Why don't you come to my house? I'm gonna go and get stuff set up for us. Let's pull out the chips and salsa, right? Vacuum a little bit, pick up the chones out of the bathroom, right? Like, I gotta go get this place ready so that it'll be ready for you to come and hang out with me. That's his invitation for us. It's a call into relationship, into community. It's our destiny. John chapter 17, verse 24. He says, Father, I want these whom you have given me to be where I am. For each of you, and I'm getting ready to wrap up. For each of you in this place, I want you to know this and really understand this. Walking with God is an invitation into community. I heard someone say it like this. He said, you cannot know God unless you walk in community. That's the only way. Because he is community. And that is his desire for us. The way that this happens, and I'm going to tell you just a couple of stories, but the way that this happens in church is through groups. Life change happens through groups. Growth happens through groups. Accountability happens through groups. This is great, and I'm so glad that you're here, but more than this, the things that you really want to happen in your heart and in your family, it happens in a group, in a small setting, 2, 3, 4, 5, whatever. My community, and once again, I'm just going to tell you a couple quick stories. I grew up in the church, and I did this my whole life, and I did the drums, and I did the, back then it was overhead, dating myself a bit, you know, transparencies, right? And I put them on backwards, and nobody could read the words, okay? Like, I did this my whole life, and I turned 17, 18 years old, and I just rejected all of it. I'm like, there's no hope here, there's no whatever, and what happened was my heart got cold, and my heart got hard, and so somebody invited me to a group, and I went to a group, and I met this lady right there, not Vanessa, the blonde chick, and she's been here a couple times, right? This is Pastor Rachel, and in the context of a group, my heart changed. God, like, ignited my heart because of community. And we're still friends with them. They've been out to our church a couple of times because of the connection that has happened. This is my buddy John Blessing. I actually reached out to a couple of these suckers, said, would you send me a video? And nobody did. Anyways, this is John Blessing. I met him going to church, and Pastor Rachel said, we go to a lot of churches, like, there's a lot of services, a lot of people. I want you to pick out somebody you don't know, a young adult, and invite them to your group. I turned around, and there's this Holly guy right there named John Blessing, if you're watching, bro. Like, these are some of my best friends on the planet. And I said, John, would you come to my group? And we got to know each other. I was the best man in his wedding. I talked to him once a month. But we grew in community. We got to know each other. This picture is of us a couple years ago when I went to Denver. We still talk. This guy, you know what I mean? We got to know Pablo in a group setting. It was called Master's Commission, but it was a small group, and we really got to know one another. He became one of my best friends on the planet because of the connection that was made in a group. We love these guys. They're crazy. They followed us out here. This is my buddy Nick Parker. Dude, Nick, this guy has been through a lot. Dude, and if you're watching, hang in there, man. He's been through a ton. We met in church. We became brothers in a group. And when his life fell apart, guess who he called? And when I struggled, guess who I called? This is one of my brothers. But it only happens in the context of a group. Brandon, man, this guy, I love Brandon Ahu. He's the reason we moved to Hawaii. I love this guy. But we got to know each other in a leadership group. We got to know each other. We became friends because of a group. My brother, you know what I mean? I met, you can't not love Oyo when you first meet him, right? I'm like, I like this guy. But you know where him and I got to know each other? We were at a group, it was a jam session group, right? Bro, check this out. I have a video.
What?
Wow.
Oh, wait. Wait up, sorry. Oh, now I gotta skip through all of them. Forgive me, guys. Sorry, Alan, I forgot. Ready? Here it is. That's where bonds are formed. That's where, for us, we go to that next level. I got one more picture and then I'm going to stop talking. I like this guy. Talia has become one of my best friends. And it's happened, not in this context, not in this area. It's happened the one-on-one. It's happened the difficult times. It's happened the moments where I call him or he calls me and says, dude, I don't know. And on Wednesdays, we started this group, and I wish we could invite everybody, but it's just because of how it works. Wednesdays at lunch, we meet together, and there's five of us, and we just tell each other everything, man. It gets ugly. But lives are changing. Hearts are open. It's because God created us to live in context of community. We cannot do it on our own. And so the thing that I want to tell you this morning, and this is where we're going to wrap up, is it's time to accept God's invitation into community. And not just your crew, not just your squad. That's good. Don't let go of that. Don't throw that away. But people that are going to encourage you to grow. People that are going to encourage you to get closer to God. We're going to wrap up, and Alan's going to put on some worship music. But on our website, we actually have we have a groups button now, and we don't have a ton of groups. We're still working on a lot of that, but you can see it here, groups. And if you click on that button, we've got a handful of them that you can join. If there's a group that maybe you want to start, you go, hey, dude, I like to go to the beach, and I want people to come out. It doesn't necessarily even have to be a super spiritual moment. It just needs to be people that love God hanging out with people that love God. Does that make sense? And I want to invite you into community. So this morning, we're going to ask the same question we ask every week. What is God speaking? to me. As your pastors, Dennis and I, we would say, we want everybody to get on that website. You can do it on your phone and go look and see if there's anything that fits. If there's not, email me and we'll create something. Let's go. We're going to be going every other Friday to the beach in June. Come out, bro. Just bring something to eat. Bring a beach chair. Let's just do community. Let's do life together. That's our desire. But the question is, what is God speaking to you? I want you to close your eyes with me. Father, we recognize that you have called us into community. We recognize, Lord, that you've created us that way. And each of us, Lord, in this room, we've said yes to you. We've said yes to relationship with you, God. Maybe we didn't know we were saying yes to relationship with others. Father, this morning we say yes. We intentionally say yes to community. But that's why you designed us. That's why we named the church Elevate Community, because we believe that that's what you do. You elevate the community in our lives. And so, Father, I pray right now in Jesus' name that you would have your way in our hearts, that you would speak loud and clear about this step that you want us to take. God, we desperately need you. And we pray right now, God, that you would lead us into community. In Jesus' name. We're going to dismiss, and I would remind you, take a card and invite somebody. But if you're here and you want a little bit of extra prayer because you feel like you've had a community before, maybe you've lost it, or you're deeply desiring that right now, and you need specific prayer about that, please come up. We're going to pray for you. But I want to tell you that I love you, and I am so glad that you're a part of our family. I'm so glad that you're a part of our Ohana. Love you guys. See you next week. Thank you.